We are here to talk about labor and value, a quite controversial and long-standing issue, both in political economy and in other social sciences. We have two very distinguished speakers who I've had occasion to talk about these issues with over the years, and I know they both thought a great deal about this, and I think the big trick for myself as moderator is to elicit all of the wisdom and critical insight that we can from this unusual encounter. John Roemer was telling us as we were sitting waiting to come over here that he had been to a concert in Berlin in which two pianists began by playing two pianos alternately and then some two piano music, and then got into a routine where one of them would get up and go to the other piano while the other one was playing, and they would sort of do a tag team. And this gave me the fantasy that maybe we could set this up here and get John Roemer to defend Prabhat's point of view and Prabhat to defend John Roemer's point of view alternately, but because I always find that kind of thing interesting. So we will begin with John Roemer's remarks, and I will keep a very rough time. I think the spirit of these meetings, which the one I've been at them, has been to encourage as much discussion and questioning as possible. So I'm hoping to leave quite a lot of room for you to intervene and put forward the things that you want to talk about or you want to hear about. As I do that, I would ask people to try to be brief and to the point in questions or remarks. I don't think there's anything wrong with remarks, but I think extended remarks are probably not appropriate for this particular kind of thing. So let me turn over to John Roemer.
Thank you, Duncan. I just learned, perhaps I was told earlier, that the topic was labor and value. I thought it was the labor theory of value. So I prepared my remarks under that understanding. But you'll see they don't have very much to do with the labor theory of value, perhaps. In a room of economists, I would put everything on slides, and because economists can't absorb oral communication. But since this is probably largely philosophers in here, I'm going to read my remarks, because that's what philosophers do. First, we must define embodied labor time in commodities, or the labor value of a commodity. This is the amount of labor expended in producing the commodity, plus the labor expended in producing all the inputs which are used in producing the commodity, and so forth, all the way back. Imagine this is a well-defined concept, perhaps because we have a simple enough technology that each commodity can be produced in only one way. In a market economy, at a market equilibrium, each commodity will have a price. The strict statement of the labor theory of value is that prices are proportional to these embodied labor times. However, this turns out to be false, according to the modern theory of economic equilibrium, unless the economy is an extremely simple one. The transformation problem, which concerned Marxists for many years, was the problem of explaining the deviation of equilibrium prices from labor values. However, this problem is motivated by a bad premise, namely that prices should be proportional to labor values. There's no reason that they should be. Marx made the assumption that prices were proportional to labor values in the first volume of Das Kapital, because it enabled him to construct a very simple and clear theory of exploitation. But it turns out that that assumption was unnecessary to construct a theory of exploitation. The real importance of the labor theory of value is that it enables one to define a concept of exploitation of workers. Let's look at a market equilibrium. There are capitalists who hire workers, pay them wages, take their product, and sell it for a profit. All this happens without the obvious coercion of feudalism or slavery. Workers trade their labor for the wage voluntarily on the labor market. Nobody forces them to work. Marx's question was, how could the economic surplus become concentrated in the hands of a small elite, the capitalists, even though all trades were voluntary? After all, explaining how this concentration could occur under feudalism or slavery was easy because of the coercive nature of those social relations and labor relations. But under capitalism, everyone is free to participate, as Milton Friedman said, free to choose. So how could a system of voluntary trades end up concentrating great wealth in the hands of a few? Marx's answer was this: examine the labor embodied in the consumption goods which the worker purchases with his wage. Call this amount of labor X. Compare this to the time that he worked. Call this Y. Marx observed that Y is greater than X. The worker works longer than the amount of time embodied in the commodities which he can purchase with his earnings. What happens to the extra labor? It becomes embodied in goods that capitalists sell for a profit. This is what Marx called surplus labor. Somehow, under capitalism, workers systematically receive back in goods embodied labor which is less than the labor they expended in production. Marx denoted this fact exploitation. Exploitation is a technical concept in Marxian economics, defined by looking at these labor accounts. This is correct. I mean, the analysis is correct. But it's a fact which is not easily observed. It's a fact which is not easily observed by workers or by anyone, because a worker may make auto fenders all day, but purchase with his wage a bundle of commodities, food, shelter, an automobile, and so on. It's not obvious that he's providing more labor in production than he receives back in the goods he can purchase with his earnings. Now, to make this important observation does not require any claim that prices are proportional to labor values. So that claim is a red herring. That is, it's irrelevant for the theory of exploitation, which is the important part of Marx's theory. For Marx wanted to explain why concentration of wealth occurred in a small class who possessed capital, even in a system of voluntary fair exchange, a system in which there's no coercion to participate in the production process. This is not to deny that on the fringes of capitalism, slavery, indentured labor, shanghaiing of sailors to man ships, and so on, existed. So there was some coercive labor. Now, why does this occur, this exploitation? This is a question of positive economics, and it's most easily seen by using modern microeconomics, not Marx's old-fashioned attempt to explain it. It turns out it's rather easy to show the following. There are three conditions which give rise to exploitation. They're all necessary. First of all, the capital stock available must be scarce relative to the labor that desires employment. Secondly, the ownership of the capital stock must be unequal, i.e., it's not owned equally by all or by some state agent. Thirdly, there are competitive labor and commodity markets. To see why exploitation occurs, think of markets as a venue for bargaining. Workers want access to the capital stock, for if they don't participate and use it, they'll have very low incomes, let's say as subsistence farmers, on poor plots of land, or selling apples on street corners, maybe which they pick in the wild. But since capital is relatively scarce, the wage in a competitive market will be bid down to the, quote, subsistence level that Marx talked about. That is, workers will keep underbidding other workers to have access to factory jobs until the wage is low enough that they become indifferent between working in the factory and on the subsistence farm or selling apples from a cart on the street. One way of putting it is that workers are paying rent to the capitalist for the privilege of working on his capital stock, which makes the worker's labor more productive. This in turn implies, it can be shown, that the labor embodied in wage goods is less than the labor expended in production, and so the worker is exploited. And this, it all happens at equilibrium prices in a neoclassical competitive equilibrium without any reference to labor values as prices, although labor values are necessary to define embodied labor times and therefore exploitation. Now we come to an important point. Is the rent workers are paying to the capitalist ethically all right, or is it immoral? This is the key question. Although Marx calls this rent an instance of exploitation, a loaded word, is it really an immoral or unjust deal? Well, one might say it all depends on how it came to be that ownership of capital was concentrated in the hands of a small class. This is why Marx wrote the last section of Capital, Volume 1, called The Secret of the Original Accumulation, or The Original Accumulation of Capital, I don't remember the exact title, in which he attempted to show that capital in Great Britain was accumulated by robbery, plunder, enclosing the commons, and so on. In other words, the unequal ownership of capital came into being in immoral ways. And hence, profits being based on immoral deeds are morally tainted. Marx spent many years in the British Museum researching the development of capitalism in England in an attempt to make this argument. Now, this poses a question. Suppose capital is accumulated in a clean way, by hard work and imagination, Bill Gates, maybe. Would it still be exploitative to hire workers and pay them competitive wage? This is Robert Nozick's query in Anarchy, State, and Utopia, which he wrote in 1974. Nozick argues that luck is a legitimate way to acquire assets, but robbery, plunder, and enclosures are not. So if you created capital by the luck of having a good brain or a strong muscles, and if others participate voluntarily in working for you, everything is morally okay, says Nozick. There's no exploitation from an ethical viewpoint. Marx himself did not deal with this problem. As I said, he was content to say that capital always rose covered in blood. End of story. Certainly, capitalist history is in large part a story of shady dealings, if not outright murder, genocide, and so on. But we must face the question of whether a clean capitalism is possible, and if it is, what is its moral status? In other words, Nozick's question. Some will argue that a clean capitalism is never possible, and if that were so, we never need to face the critical ethical question of whether clean capitalism would be ethically acceptable. I prefer to say that there are many examples of clean capitalism, maybe not entire nations, but certainly some capitalist transactions within some capitalist economies. Are we to say that the Korean grocers who work 80 hours a week in the corner store are not entitled to eventually buy their own store, hire workers, and prosper? After all, they built the capital on their own labor. The answer is offered by modern political philosophy, beginning with Rawls and extending through Ronald Dworkin, G.A. Cohen, Richard Arneson, and others. Suppose we take the viewpoint that the distribution of families into which children are born is morally arbitrary. The genetic makeup one is born with is a matter of luck. And now, crucially, we deny Nozick's postulate that luck is an acceptable way of acquiring assets. Then, to the extent that those who end up accumulating capital do so as a result of their family backgrounds, genetic makeup, the social status that came with their family backgrounds, and the education which followed from this, that accumulation is unacceptable, for it's a consequence of luck. Or rather, the unequal incomes that follow from having that accumulation are unacceptable. Rawls would say the possession of these assets is morally arbitrary. The condemnation of Marxian exploitation now becomes a much subtler undertaking. It's not due to the fact that capital was accumulated by robbery and plunder, but rather to its being accumulated through the good luck of the birth lottery, or in large part so accumulated. But note, what really follows from this argument is not that exploitation as such is morally bad, that is to say, these unequal labor accounts, but rather that inequality of condition is morally bad to the extent that it results from the luck of the birth lottery. Sure, it's still true that Marxist exploitation is taking place in a capitalist system, but it's not of great interest to compare accounts of labor expended against labor consumed in commodities. What's at issue is unjust inequality of condition. So modern political philosophy of the genre that I'm referring to is a more general theory of injustice than the theory of exploitation. and I think this is the correct theory. What kind of inequality is morally okay? It's inequality that is not due to luck, but to choice. Suppose we compensate people for the bad luck of the birth lottery through a wonderful educational system and so on, and through very stiff inheritance taxes and other ways of preventing intergenerational transfers. Nevertheless, as autonomous adults, people make different choices and end up having capitalist relations with each other, supposing this is not forbidden. As Nozick says, capitalist acts between consenting adults are okay. Would the ensuing exploitation be bad? And assuredly, exploitation in the sense that some would pay rent, in the sense that some would pay rent for access to the capital accumulated by others, would continue to exist. Well, you can challenge whether choice is ever autonomous. Maybe your choices are determined by a mixture of your environment, which you're not responsible for, and your genes, which are a matter of luck, and so we should not admit any realm for choice. Most people would balk at this view. And indeed, people who are called compatibilists in philosophy don't accept it. They believe that the idea of the causal thesis, that all actions have a material proximate cause, is not inconsistent with the idea that there's such a thing as responsible choice. There's a non-empty realm for autonomous choice, most of us believe. Certainly that's the way we raise our children. And so it must be possible that clean capitalist acts can exist and are not exploitative in the ethical sense. Nevertheless, as a matter of practical policy, I would still advocate a socialist economy as the goal, where the accumulation of private productive assets is forbidden. And this is entirely because of practical considerations, namely because I don't think we can ever properly compensate people for the bad luck of the birth lottery, and so I want to create institutions that make it difficult for some people to gain unfairly from other people's labor. Just as feudalism made the slave bond illegal, and capitalism made the feudal bond illegal, so I believe socialism should make the capitalist bond illegal, namely private property and the means of production. Most capital should be collectively owned. It's therefore up to socialist economists like me to figure out how we can design an economy that would run efficiently if capital were not privately owned. This is not the place to begin that discussion. We could begin it in the question period. Human ingenuity is always surprising. It turns out, what Marx and Engels would never have predicted, I think, that the societies which are closest to achieving the ideal that inequality of condition due to luck of the birth lottery be eliminated are not the societies that have abolished private property and capital. They're the Nordic economies, in which the capital stock is in large part privately owned in a highly concentrated manner. These societies have redistributed income through taxation to a remarkable degree and are the ones, in my view, closest to achieving the socialist ideal today. Their example is of utmost importance to the rest of the world. How they came into existence is a most important question, and whether their example can be transported to large heterogeneous societies is another. What these societies show us is that we must be open-minded concerning the institutional design that can be used to achieve the goal of eliminating inequality of condition that is not due to choice. They also put the lie to the right wing's claim that deep taxation will destroy productivity and innovation. I think you can see why I believe that the labor theory of value is not important today. As a theory of what equilibrium prices are, it's a non-starter. As a way of conceptualizing exploitation, it's technically correct, but the kind of exploitation it defines is really a special case of a more general kind of unjustifiable inequality, namely inequality due to circumstances of individuals over which they have no control. What's wrong with capitalism, in a word, is not that capitalists receive more labor from workers than workers can purchase back with their wage income, but rather that capitalism is a system which enables people to gain tremendous wealth from the lucky possession of good genes, good families, and good social connections. That's the reason capitalism is bad, not because of the Marxian labor accounts that I've described. What we want to eliminate are institutions like private ownership of productive assets, and maybe we don't even have to eliminate that one, which enable huge inequalities of condition to develop from that kind of luck.
Thank you, John, for a remarkably and characteristically succinct and clear argument to start things off. Prabhat, I do not envy you at this point.
Thanks, Kanti. I have a somewhat different take on this issue. So let me just lay down the basic premises on the basis of which I would be talking about the labor theory of value. Classical political economy drew a distinction between market prices and natural prices. Natural prices obtained when there was the possibility of supply adjustments. The natural prices were seen to be the center of gravity towards which the market prices tended to move. The natural prices, in turn, could be determined if you have the wage rate and the conditions of production. The wage rate in terms of any good, given the conditions of production, would give you the relative prices, which were the natural prices in terms of that good. Now, Marx added to this a notion of value, so that he was really talking in terms of three price concepts: values, prices of production, which were his way of looking at natural prices, and the market prices. He also agreed that market prices tended to gravitate towards natural prices or towards prices of production. But then he introduced this notion of value in order, as John said, in order to show the genesis of exploitation, and in particular, in order to argue that exploitation occurred, or the extraction of surplus value occurred in the process of production. Once extraction of surplus value in the process of production had taken place, and if you assume that all labor is homogeneous, they get the same wages, work the same hours, then the rate of exploitation of every worker is the same. So the principle on which exploitation took place is that it was identical for all workers. But the principle on the basis of which the surplus value, the total of it so extracted, was distributed among capitalists, is that each of them gets the same rate of profit. In order to show this, Marx basically assumed that the surplus value which is extracted is in fact what is distributed through the prices of production. And he asserted that the sum of values is the same as the sum of prices of production, and the sum of surplus value is the same as the sum of the profits that are distributed through the prices of production. Now, these two, except in very exceptional circumstances, generally do not hold. As a result, there was a technical flaw in Marx's analysis, because of which many people have said that the labor theory of value then just becomes, if you like, a rich description. You manage to say many things about capitalism, but you don't need to bring in the labor values. The labor theory of value then just becomes a rich description, but when it comes to the actual analysis of capitalism, we should begin with the prices of production, which really are the center of gravity. Now, the question is this true? Now, in my view, no. In other words, in my view, the labor theory of value, or the labor theory of value approach is what I'd be talking about, really plays a very central role. And what is more, I'd like to argue that there is no other theoretical system in economics which actually can either substitute the labor theory of value approach, or that the labor theory of value approach is something which is irrelevant, unrealistic, and so on. Now, the reason I say this is because capitalism is fundamentally a money-using economy. Wages are paid in money. If wages are paid in money, then of course it becomes very important to find out what is the terms of exchange between commodities on the one side and money on the other side. How is it that we actually know how commodities, the world of commodities, exchanges against money? Now, the typical answer to this, which was given by Ricardo, which is given by Walras, which was given by the classicals as well as the neoclassicals, other than by Marx and to an extent Keynes, whom I'll come to later, is to argue that money is like any other commodity. In Ricardo, as I said, the prices of production are in fact determined, and money also has a price of production. If the money wages are given, and you find that the conditions of production are all given, then of course you get a price of production of all commodities in terms of money. So the idea was that money enters into this general world of commodities across which the wages and the rates of profit are equalized, and it enters like any other commodity. Now, if you accept, and likewise in the Walrasian system, which is the modern kind of, you know, economic equilibrium, the argument is that all prices are determined by demand and supply, and such is the case with the price of money. The price of money vis-a-vis whatever other commodities we take is also determined by the demand and supply of money, and the price of money is nothing else but the general price level of the commodities, and that is also determined by basically the demand and supply of money. Now, this entire tradition of treating money as if it is like any other commodity is a tradition that is based on what is called the quantity theory of money. Imagine the Ricardian system. The Ricardian system says that, of course, like any commodity, if the supply of money rises, then its market price must fall. To say its market price must fall is the same as saying that all prices must rise. So money supply increases, raise the money prices of all commodities. That's basically what Mr. Friedman is arguing. That's basically quantity theory of money. Marx was totally opposed to it. In fact, the quantity theory of money is something which makes sense only if money is a medium of circulation. But if money is not just a medium of circulation, but also a form in which wealth is held, then the quantity theory of money does not hold. Suppose money supply rises, but there is no demand for commodities, people just hold the money as wealth, then there is no reason why the prices of commodities should increase. As a result, the moment you introduce money, not just as a medium of circulation, but money as a form of wealth, then the quantity theory assumption is something which breaks down. And what is more, you must do that, because when you say money is a medium of circulation, what does it mean? It means that I go and sell commodities. You remember Marx's CMC circuit. I go and sell commodities, get hold of money, with that I go and buy commodities. Therefore, in the medium of circulation role of money, there is a fleeting moment in which I'm holding my wealth in the form of money. Now, there is no reason why, if people hold their wealth for a fleeting moment, they should not do so for more than a fleeting moment. And the moment you do that, then of course money ceases to be only a medium of circulation, but also becomes a form in which wealth is held. Now, if money is held in the form, if wealth is held in the form of money, therefore the idea of treating money on a par with all other commodities, exactly analogous, exactly identical, is something which simply is logically unsustainable. If so, then you'd have to have a rule for determining the ratio in which money exchanges against the world of commodities as a prior thing, on the basis of which then you can determine the money prices of commodities. If you like, you need a meta-pricing rule. Now, the labor theory of value, to my mind, is an attempt at such a meta-pricing rule, namely that the money prices of all commodities are determined by the relative, by the conditions of production between the money commodity and the rest of the commodities. Of course, it's a first approximation. Gold producers, for instance, may have a monopoly. They may actually jack up the relative exchange rate, but those do not, as it were, constitute problems in the sense that, you know, while as a matter of fact, the relative labor embodied may not explain the exchange ratio, but fundamentally what the labor theory of value is saying is that you have to have this exchange ratio determined in a way different from the exchange ratios that you determine among the commodities themselves, that money cannot be treated on a par with every other commodity because of the fact that it is a form in which wealth is held. Now, this approach is something which I would in fact say really consists of three propositions. The first proposition, which I've already said, is that money is not only a medium of circulation, but a form in which wealth is held. The second proposition is that if you have a stock of fixed capital which is utilized, there's a certain degree of capacity utilization, the output that is produced has a certain money value which is independent of the supply of money. Third, as money wages rise, the rate of profit must fall. Now, of course, when money wages rise, it may give rise to all kinds of macroeconomic disturbances, you may move to some new equilibrium, but fundamentally the proposition I have in mind is that when money wages rise, given the output, the rate of profit must fall. In other words, it's the given output rate of profit that must fall when money wages rise. I believe these three propositions, each of which is in a sense extremely relevant in our understanding of capitalism, capitalist reality, these three propositions together do not figure in any theoretical system, and this includes the Keynesian one as well. Let me try and say why. You see, because if you say money is a form of holding wealth, that basically is what makes possible the crisis of overproduction. It's what makes possible recessions. Imagine, what is a recession? A recession is one in which if you produce the maximal amount of output that's possible to produce, there would not be enough demand for it, which in economics parlance, you would say there's an ex-ante excess supply of commodities. But then that naturally raises the question that an ex-ante excess supply of commodities must mean an ex-ante excess demand for something else. That something else is money. So that if money was not being demanded as a form of wealth, in that case, problems of aggregate demand simply would not arise. Say's law, what economists call the Say's law, supply creates its own demand, there's never a problem of demand, would invariably hold if money was not a form of wealth. So insofar as we know that in life there is recession, there's overproduction, money is a form of wealth, therefore the first proposition of the labor theory of value approach that I'm talking about is a proposition that is undeniable. Look at the second proposition. The second proposition says that nonetheless, at a certain, that there is, given a certain amount of output that is produced, it has a certain determinate unique money value. Now that proposition, the moment you accept that the money value of commodity is not determined by quantity theory, by demand and supply, there must be some independent means of its determination. And once that happens, then of course the money value of these commodities is determined independent of the supply of money. So the second proposition is linked to the first. The third proposition is actually the most interesting one, namely as money wages rise, the rate of profit, the given output rate of profit must fall. Now this does not occur in Keynesian economics. This does not occur in Kaleski even. Why? Because in Keynesian economics, the amount of profits is given. If you have a given output, there is a certain given, the given output and the given profits is determined by the level of aggregate demand. And therefore, if you have, and that given output is produced by a certain number of people, given number of laborers, the wage bill therefore is output minus profits, and so real wages get determined, and if real wages are determined, if money wages rise, then of course all prices rise. Therefore, you have a situation where, in Keynesian economics, money wages rise, rate of profit does not fall. If money wages rise, prices rise. If money wages rise, it's not the case that the rate of profit actually falls. Now you may say that is because Marx was talking about commodity money, gold and so on, while Keynes is talking about fiat money, credit money, in short paper money. But actually the distinction is not that. That distinction is not very relevant. Anything in terms of which wealth is held must have a degree of stability in its value vis-a-vis commodities. Therefore, if money is to function as wealth, then a rise in money wages cannot simply give rise to an increase in all money prices, because then money would cease to be wealth. Then who's going to hold wealth in the form of money if it is the case that money prices can always rise whenever there is a rise in money wages? As a result, the fact that when money wages rise, the rate of profit falls, is a property of money as a form of wealth. As a matter of fact, what we observe is the obverse of it. What we observe is that to prevent money wages from rising, which would give rise either to a fall in the rate of profit or to an increase in money prices, and therefore the role of money as a form of holding wealth would cease to operate, to prevent that from happening, you have to prevent money wages from rising. And this is done throughout the history of capitalism, including today, by having an enormous reserve army of labor. Typically, the role of the reserve army of labor has always been understood, A, that it introduces discipline into the work process, because you can sack the fellow if he doesn't listen to you. You know, the right to hire and fire, the threat of the sack, is what introduces discipline in the capitalist system. The feudal lord had the monseigneur's whip, so that if somebody didn't work, you whipped him. But in a capitalist system, based on these voluntary contracts, obviously the only way that coercion is imposed, which is essential in the work process, is by having a reserve army of labor. The second thing, role of the reserve army of labor, which is recognized by everybody, is that distribution. It prevents the rate of profit from falling to zero, because obviously if you have a reserve army of labor, then wages are stuck at a certain level, and the difference in productivity and wages is something which accrues to the capitalists as profits. But there is, in addition to these, a further role of the reserve army of labor, namely a monetary system. The capitalist system, based on the use of money, would get completely destabilized if you did not have a reserve army of labor. Now, if you have a reserve army of labor, then imagine, what is the constraint on output in any period? One constraint, obviously, which was talked about by John, is that the level of capital stock is fixed. The other possible constraint would be that the level of employment is fixed. The number of workers is limited, is fixed. The third constraint could be the demand is not adequate. But in addition to all these, there's a fourth constraint, namely that even if you have enough capital stock, even if you have enough number of workers, even if you have, let's say, a state intervening in demand management, the state cannot do so beyond a point if it is the case that the reserve army shrinks such that the monetary system of capitalism gets destabilized, if you have inflation and so on. Now, this is something that Joan Robinson, as a Keynesian economist, had recognized at that time, but Keynes himself did not do so, and it's a major factor behind the fact that Keynesian economics got into disrepute, and you have people coming up with all this natural rate of unemployment, non-accelerating rate of unemployment, that beyond a certain point the state cannot intervene, etc. All these arise because of a fundamental flaw in Keynesian economics. Now, from this, therefore, it would follow, I mean, a number of conclusions follow from this. The first conclusion, let me just state very clearly, that market socialism, unless it also has, I mean, after all, it's not just the ownership, market socialism, unless it also has a reserve army of labor of this kind, since it's imitating capitalism, would also be submerged in accelerating inflation. A market socialism is unworkable without a reserve army of labor to stabilize the monetary system, which would then prevail. So even the conception of socialism we have is something which is not independent of our analysis of capitalism. The second thing that would follow, and this probably the last point I'm going to make, sorry, is that, you know, that just as an increase in money wages can destabilize the monetary system of capitalism, an increase in the prices of all kinds of raw materials that capitalism imports from outside can also destabilize. Therefore, it becomes very important, just as it becomes important to maintain a sufficient reserve army of labor in capitalism to maintain the stability of the value of money, likewise becomes important to have an imperial system, to have a system of imperialism in order to control the prices at which you can actually get all kinds of raw materials from outside to preserve the stability of the monetary system of capitalism. And what is more, even if you have some increase in money wages, to the extent that there is that component, which is being imported from outside, whose prices can be controlled, the increase in money wages do not necessarily give rise to any acceleration in inflation. They peter out. They give rise to some price increases, but there's an important component, of course, which is not increasing, and therefore it plays the role of stabilizing the capitalist system and stabilizing the value of money in the capitalist system, in which not only is wealth held in the form of money, but wealth is also held in an enormous mass of money determined, assets whose values are, as it were, determined, denoted in terms of money. So my point is that the labor theory of value approach to macroeconomics and to money is something which not only gives us, in a sense, a meta rule for the determination of prices, but what is more, on which Duncan has done a lot of work, but what is more, it opens up a whole range of questions about the macroeconomics of capitalism, which no other system, theoretical system in economics does.
Thank you, Prabhat, for an equally amazingly, equally clear and compelling statement. I should tell the audience that these are not exactly improvisations. Both John and Prabhat have been working on this act for quite a long time, and there's a lot of preparation behind it. I'm going to possibly abuse my role as chair to just make a couple of remarks about the presentations, more perhaps in the style of a Brechtian spectator. Brecht said you should go to the theater the way you go to a boxing match, with your bowler, your hat on your head, and your cigar in your teeth, and just see how it's going to come out. And one of the things about understanding how it comes out is to become a little aware of the finer points. So I'd just like to make a couple of observations. First of all, although the focus of the two presentations is in many ways very different, I think it's very important to realize that in many ways they're not at all inconsistent. And in fact, that the side of understanding capitalist social relations that John Roemer comes to, which is based a lot in what is called microeconomics, is to a certain extent complementary to the point of view that Prabhat was enunciating, which starts from fundamentally macroeconomic set of issues. One of the curses of economics and political economy in general in our time has been a division between a micro focus and a macro focus, and the elusiveness of any kind of very convincing technical synthesis. And this is not just a problem within the discourse of Marxist economics, but also in mainstream economics as well. As you, if you are at all new to this particular sport, you may notice that there's also a division here between a focus in John's remarks on the distributional contradictions of capitalism, inequality, the concentration of wealth, and a focus in Prabhat's remarks on money and on the stability problems, stability of capitalism, which he comes back to increasingly. But if you go through those two paths, there is a meeting point, I think, which is that what Prabhat's view of the role of the World Reserve Army in regulating money wages and therefore the stability of the capitalist system is actually not inconsistent with John's original sketch of where profits come from in terms of the availability of jobs, the importance of workers having to bid against each other in a certain sense, bid downwards for jobs. I would just like to make three more points. One is that there's also a difference between a broad and a narrow church version of the labor theory of value. So I think John's statement of the labor theory of value is what I would call the narrow church version, that it boils down to the claim that actual prices or natural prices or some center of gravitation of prices ought to reflect the relative labor times embodied in different commodities. Prabhat emphasizes what I would call a broader church version of the labor theory of value, that it's in part a heuristic, it's a way of thinking about the origin of surplus value and the rate of profit. It's inherently a monetary theory, and in the sense that money is a key part of it. And those two poles of discussion have been very important in the history of this. I'd like to say another thing about the critique. So from the point of view of these two talks, what's wrong with capitalism? I mean, after all, most of us get up every morning and we go to work and we have food on the table and we are reasonably well housed and well clothed. So what is the problem? What is the contradiction? Well, we know that there are contradictions, and I think the two talks emphasize aspects of the difficulties of capitalism, which, as I say, are kind of complementary but distinctly different. So John is emphasizing the moral discomfort about capitalism. Because we live in a society, even though we individually may be getting up and having enough to eat and clothing ourselves and so forth, we still are meeting people all the time who clearly are having a much, much tougher time with that. And that means that it's very difficult. This leads to this thing that you see in New York all the time. It's very remarkable that we can't confront everybody we meet in a certain sense as equals, and give them a kind of level of respect and comradeship that we probably feel is part of what we would like to have out of human life and out of human society. For Prabhat, puts the emphasis on another very basic contradiction, which is the contradiction of stability and how well is the system working anyway. This question of the accumulation of money as a form of wealth and the failure of the quantity of money theory of prices is, of course, extremely acute right at the moment, right this very moment. The velocity of money has plunged in the United States, if you measure it by any statistical measures. And we know that that is behind a good deal of discussion of political economy. I would like to put another thing on the table. It's very hard to get Marxists to talk about this, but I think it's important that we do try to talk about alternatives, or what we conceive of as alternatives. Prabhat mentioned market socialism as one element in this array of alternatives. If we would go back to Marx's lifetime and we were having this discussion, I think for Marx the problems of the morality of capitalism and the stability of capitalism were very closely linked. And the problem of the morality of capitalism was basically, he said, look, we have this huge power of production. Workers can produce way more than they need in order to survive and reproduce. And therefore, why do we need capitalism? Why? What's the function of capitalism? And if there's no function to it, then the moral case for it becomes all the weaker. Now, we live after 100 years after the Soviet of experience of political economy, after the Soviet experiment, And I think we're a great deal warier of the idea that there are simple alternatives to capitalism that we can just go like to the box out in the hall that says break glass in case of emergency and smash up some part of the system and get that axe out of there and solve the problem. I don't think we do, but I'd like to hear a little bit more about what both Prabhat and John, and indeed everybody here, is thinking about those questions of alternatives. So I would suggest that the way we proceed, I think I'm in fact in charge of this, so I think I'm actually going to decide how we proceed. And I would like, the way I'd like to proceed is I want to go back and give Prabhat and John a chance to respond to each other, and we have quite a bit of time, so we can do that. But I think it would be very useful at this point to throw the floor open to questions. Remarks are okay, but as I said, let's keep them short. Yeah. Maybe introduce, I don't know, is it
worth it? My name's Scott. I'm a Columbia alum.
Okay.
This is not a remark, but it's going to start off just very, very short. And what I would propose listening to Prabhat's comment is dealing with the sort of invariancy of high levels of unemployment, which I think are very key to what Professor Roemer said as well. Is I wonder if thinking about high levels of unemployment as an invariant sort of gives the owners of wealth more credit than they deserve. So in other words, if you say, well, the people who are in a position to create companies and things like this realize that the whole system and their social position is predicated on a vast army of the unemployed, so they intentionally keep a vast army of the unemployed to keep their social position. It almost makes them more come across as smarter than they should be. Wouldn't an alternative, so here's the question part, wouldn't an alternative approach be to say that people in a position to create entrepreneurial enterprises and give people employment just aren't smart enough to figure out how to do that. So in other words, there doesn't need to be a vast army of unemployed. There has always been, up to this point, a vast army of unemployed. But that actually, it's actually one of the problems with Marxism is they sort of think that the capitalists are aware that there needs to be this vast army of unemployed, and that is going to, and that is essential to capitalism and will always be. What I would suggest is once you get rid of unemployment, then a lot of stuff starts to break down. And I would suggest that it's not impossible to get rid of unemployment.
I think if I would take a few more remarks, maybe three or four, and then give a chance for both Prabhat and John to reply. I see one hand, I see two hands, right next to each other. Okay, so.
John, you said we might start a conversation on how we might run a state-owned economy. What is the alternative in that sense? Can
invite you to please begin that. Okay. And just mention your names.
I'm Akbar Noman.
Akir. See you.
So this is another invitation, John. So just could you spell out a little more what your view of exploitation and the immorality of capitalism is? So just imagine, per impossibile, that one could ensure that luck was eliminated by, you know, one or other measure that you described or some other unthought of measures, and that capitalism or system of privately owned capital came via a sort of morally impeccable pedigree. You know, it didn't come from luck, but everybody who became a capitalist became a capitalist through the kinds of honest labor that you were describing, the Korean grocer. How would you, I mean, would you say that anything that follows, which leads to the kinds of things that surplus value and so on create in a capitalist system, should not be counted as morally wrong? I'm just curious how you fill it in, if one imagined this counterfactual, just so as to get more of your view out.
If there's one more person wants to throw.
I think one underlying factor is, I think Adam Smith assumed that man is a rational animal, like Aristotle, and the factor of human irrationality, I think, is perhaps the unmentioned factor. It was also pointed out that under slavery and under feudalism, the worker had a choice. I mean, he had to work. What has really changed? Yes, the worker doesn't have to accept the job if the alternative is to starve. I wouldn't call that a choice. And now economists preach austerity to Greece in its current condition. Comment.
Well, maybe we'll go the other order in this round, and maybe we'll switch back and forth. So, Prabhat, you want to respond to those questions?
Can I respond to some questions not addressed to me?
You certainly can respond to any. You can even respond to questions that weren't addressed at all.
Okay, the question of alternatives. You know, I mean, I see the question of alternative not just in terms of what an arrangement is going to be, but I see it differently. Okay, now I think any mode of production requires some way that people would be working. In other words, some inducement to work. Okay, under coercive mode, slavery, feudalism, serfdom. In capitalism, through the threat of the sack and so on. I think socialism must be a system with full employment. If it's a system with full employment, then the threat of the sack does not play a role. And consequently, it can operate only to the extent that the workers voluntarily work, okay? Without, as it were, in quotes, shirking, without any coercion being used. I mean, you can have a Stalinist system, that's a different thing, you know, I mean, where you have actual coercion being employed on the workers. But if we are thinking of an authentically socialist system, then we have to think of a system in which the workers work because they are part of a certain collective. So my notion of socialism is really one in which there is, as it were, the formation of a new community. And the seeds of that, Marx argued, arise in capitalism itself. Through trade union action, through political action of the workers, you have the coming into being of a new community, and that goes on to build socialism. So socialism is not just an organizational form, which is why if you have, let's say, market socialism, I mean, market socialism would be a form of commodity production in which, in a certain sense, the notion of the community is being subverted. And not surprisingly, as I was arguing, you could well have high rates of inflation if you have full employment in market socialism. Yugoslavia, old Yugoslavia, had substantially high unemployment and also had reasonably high rates of inflation before it collapsed. You know, so I'm not very enamored of market socialism. But my notion of socialism really focuses on this idea of how to build a community. Okay, I think the organizational forms would, in a sense, follow from that. Okay, I mean, it would, for instance, necessarily imply human freedom, it will necessarily imply democracy, it will necessarily imply a situation where there's no coercion on the workers and so on. You know, I mean, they have rights and they actively participate in political decision makings. Decisions are made politically in which they actively participate. You know, so I have a very, I would like to start from that end. Then there was the question of the reserve army. Yeah, you see, if you're talking about the reserve army, it's not as if Okay, I mean, in a recession, you can have, in the Great Depression, a huge unemployment.
I'm not down.
Oh, you're here, okay. Okay.
You're
huge unemployment. It's not as if overcoming that unemployment would necessarily give rise to inflation. Of course not. I mean, you know, countries like Japan and so on actually got rid of unemployment fairly quickly, got rid of substantial amounts of unemployment fairly quickly without it giving rise to any inflation. But the point is that nonetheless there is a threshold below which the reserve army cannot fall, a threshold below which unemployment cannot actually fall.
Why do you say that?
Yeah. Unless it is the case. I mean, you know, Keynesianism, I mean, after all, what happened in Keynesianism? Keynesianism would work if you can impose an incomes policy. And that's what the Keynesians themselves were arguing in the 1960s and 70s. That, you know, that if you have a fall in the reserve army below a certain threshold, it's going to destabilize your monetary system. It's going to give rise to massive inflation and so on, which the world did witness towards the end of the 1960s. And as a result, that time the talk was you have to have incomes policy. But you see, if you have to have incomes policy, then you are in effect already intervening in the capitalist system because then, I mean, after all, what is private property? Appropriation of surplus. But if you actually say that, look, you can't appropriate surplus beyond this much, in other words, you know, give the capitalists an income beyond which they cannot go, in that case you're already interfering in the functioning of the system. They are not going to agree to it. You can push for it. It can be a transitional demand, but it's the kind of transitional demand that would push you towards overcoming, towards transcending the system itself. I just like to very briefly respond to Akhil's question. You see that Schumpeter had this view that you know, that there are inequalities in society, but the inequalities arise because people who make innovations get that extra. But since it is the case that for making innovations you do not require ownership of property, anybody can make innovations, like, you know, and as a result you find inequalities, but in which, let's say, the composition of the top 5% is all the time changing, you know, that people, it's a theory of social mobility through innovations. But you see, the Schumpeterian system was completely based on the assumption of full employment. The moment you get rid of that assumption, it is the case that actually innovations, far from giving rise to progress as he had in mind, can just give rise to massive unemployment, because in technological progress can actually just generate massive unemployment. So the point is that, you know, that it is, you know, it's not just the fact that, you know, even if you did not have a system in which there was ownership, but you even if you had a system in which captains of industry were kind of chosen because their innovativeness, or not chosen, I mean, you know, came up because of their innovativeness, nonetheless the system can function in a way that generates unemployment.
Four big questions. So let me first take a shot at the reserve army issue. I want to make a distinction. Just if it were true that capitalism required a reserve army, that doesn't imply that capitalists will organize to have one. There may be laws of motion of the system which guarantee that a reserve army will always exist, independent of the will of individual capitalists. So I think the main reserve army today, as far as U.S. capital is concerned, are the Chinese workers who are keeping a lid on American wages. It's not something that the U.S. capitalists planned, but it occurred. Secondly, I'd like to agree with your more basic point that it may be conceivable, certainly in individual capitalist economies, to have essentially zero rates of unemployment. But that has to be accomplished by a lot of coordinated activity. In particular, let me give the example of Germany. My understanding is that the German economy is so successful and is the major exporter in Europe because the German trade unions around 10 years ago succeeded in organizing a global agreement not to fight for higher wages. Consequently, the capitalists, the firms, were able to keep their prices down and still maintain their profits, whereas in all the other countries of Europe, the unit labor costs rose quite quickly over the last decade until the crash, and they priced themselves out of the export market. So that was a pact among the trade unions to control competitive, you know, bargaining by workers in order to maintain the position of their firms in the export market, which meant that they had high unemployment and a high standard of living. So I think it's what you say in principle is conceivable, but it's not the kind of capitalism that existed in the 19th century and that Marx was talking about. Secondly, let me answer or Akhil's question. What if you could design a capitalist system in which the only reason that capital were accumulated was because of autonomous choice and hard work and the advantages due to family background and even due to inborn talents were eliminated? And so essentially we have a system where there's some people who want to work all the time and earn a lot of money and consume at a high level, and there are other people who want to just work enough to survive and otherwise write poetry or surf, right? And so the capitalists in this world would exploit the workers. Would that be okay? And I would say yes. Under those premises, it would be fine. Now, the other, in other words, I don't object to inequalities which are due to differences in autonomous choice once equality of opportunity of a very thorough kind has been assured. That is to say, the effect of circumstances beyond the control of individuals on their choices and on their condition, their material condition has been eliminated. So I'd say that'd be okay, with a caveat. I agree with Duncan, who enunciated something very important, that fraternity, comradeship, a society in which people are concerned about each other, is a component of the ideal society, of what's called socialism. And to the extent that material inequalities become so large that that kind of fraternity is precluded, I think they have to be controlled. So I would say that the necessity of having fraternity trumps the legitimacy of inequalities due to autonomous choice. I don't know what that level of inequality is, but I think it's only fair that I should cite the philosopher who has made these points most recently, who is Jerry Cohen, G.A. Cohen, who died several years ago but was a visitor to this department a number of times. And Cohen, in his last book, which was really an essay, but it was published as a small book, this format, very, very small book, by Princeton University Press, called Why Not Socialism, defined the socialist a socialism as a system in which the only inequalities which existed were those of the kind we've been discussing, namely those due to autonomous choice, once full equality of opportunity has been implemented. But, he said, the second requirement of socialism is the feeling of what he called community, or fraternity, comradeship, that people, in his language, want to work in order to serve each other and in turn be served by them, rather than working simply to earn your own subsistence. So Cohen insisted on these two things, and I think that's the answer to Akhil. From the point of view of justice, I don't think there's anything wrong with that kind of inequality, but we may refuse to permit it because it compromises this other necessary condition of a good society. The last question, no, there are two more questions. Choice under capitalism, the gentleman here. I think that we have to admit there's a big difference between being coerced to work by the threat of the whip or being killed or something, which, what the kinds of things which coerce people to work under feudalism and slavery, and the choice that the proletarian faces. It's a very different kind of thing. Now, I agree that workers are, as a collective, unable to escape being workers. We can't all become shopkeepers. There will have to be people who work for a wage under a market system. At least it's very hard to envision that there wouldn't be. And so in a collective sense, I think workers are forced to work. But it's not true for any individual. Any individual, in principle, can escape the working class and become a shopkeeper or even a capitalist or a highly paid professional and not be exploited in the usual way, at least. Finally, the question that really interests me the most, is the issue of what the design of socialism should be. What kind of institutions, this man in the front row, what kind of institutions could be used to organize a socialist economy? And this, again, was proposed by Jerry Cohen, this question in the book Why Not Socialism that I just mentioned. Jerry wrote that he felt that socialism, suppose we have a people who have the socialist ethos. I mean, they actually do want to live in a socialist sort of community in which people are motivated by wanting to serve each other and in turn be served by them. Economic institutions could be used to organize a relatively efficient kind of economic process in under those conditions. Cohen believed that the necessary motivators in a market economy are greed and fear. Fear of the sack, as Prabhat is saying, and insecurity, that is to say, and greed in the sense of simply wanting to earn as much money as possible. In the capitalist, this takes a particularly pathological form, which Prabhat described, of just wanting to turn wealth into more wealth and viewing the production process as simply a means to that end rather than a means of serving people. I don't believe that markets require greed and fear to be used. I think we're going to have markets as far ahead as I can see, even if we become thoroughly socialist. But I don't think that markets require or even necessarily generate greed and fear. I think greed and fear are generated more basically by scarcity. That is to say, by living in a period of history in which the main struggle is the struggle to survive. And I think we're actually coming to an end of that period. I think the advances that indeed capitalist competition has brought through innovation and technological change, I think are really bringing us to the first time in the history of man that we're not going to be facing scarcity. And I think, this has happened. We see very rapidly the huge increases in income in China and even now beginning in India and in Brazil and Indonesia. So the developing world, large parts of it, are overcoming scarcity in the sense in which it existed 100 years ago. And I think scarcity has been in large part overcome in the advanced economies. Certainly the potential to overcome scarcity for everyone exists, as Duncan says, but in many, many countries it's actually, it really has been implemented. There's just very, very little poverty in some advanced capitalist countries, particularly the Nordic countries. So I think when we get to that point, which I think will be the case in the next few hundred years, that most of the world will be beyond a period of where material privation was the main motivator for economic activity, I think that markets can operate without greed and fear and can be used even in a socialist, when people have a socialist ethos. Now, I still think that great improvements can be made over in economic distribution by enhancing cooperation. I think we have three major examples of cooperation that have developed in the last period. What are they? I was just writing about this afternoon, so I'll try to remember. One is the state. I mean, the fact that advanced economies now, although the advanced capitalist economies don't haven't collectivized the ownership of productive assets, they have collectivized to a great deal the distribution of income. So about half of the gross national product or gross domestic product of many European countries goes to the state through taxation. So this would have been a big surprise to Marx and Engels, I think, who thought that the only way of that it was much more fundamental to collectivize the ownership of productive assets than to simply tax. But it seems that taxation is the way that's really led to collective control of income. So the state in northern European countries collects half of the gross national product, gross domestic product, and uses it to finance public goods and to insure people against insecurity and to redistribute income. I'm afraid I'm not remembering my other two big examples of cooperation. But what I want to point out is that I think that we've just begun this period of having major cooperation in economic life. And I think that as this period of deprivation, of material deprivation, passes, I think we're going to have more cooperation. And that will help people, become more socialist in their ethos. When they see the possibilities for cooperation, I think that they, and when the threat of material deprivation disappears, people will have the freedom to think of something other than that. I think that they'll come to have more concern for other people. So my view, I used to think, I wrote a book in 1994 called The Future for Socialism, in which the task was to try to design a system of market socialism even with people as they are today. That is to say, with many people being afflicted with greed and consuming self-interest. I now think that that's not an interesting question. I think the interesting question is to try to design an economy that works when people do have this socialist ethos that Cohen talked about, because I think that ethos is going to be developed. And furthermore, I think that the task that I set myself in 1994 was impossible. I don't think we ever, conversely, can design a socialist economy if people don't have a socialist ethos. I think this last crisis is an instance of that. This wasn't socialism, but the point is all the well-laid plans of people to try to prevent huge crises from occurring failed, because there's always a way that smart and greedy people can find a way around the rules to enrich themselves and take risks which are, from a social point of view, indefensible. That's what happened. So I believe the main cause of this crisis was not was actually greed. It was the capitalist ethos, the bourgeois ethos, which got capitalists of various kinds and traders and people in the financial sector to undertake activities which were done purely because of greed, and ended up you know the results. So. My view is that market socialism is not the main issue. The main issue is thinking about the evolution of socialist ethos, and asking ourselves what, in addition to markets, can be used to organize activity when people are thinking in that way.
Thanks. Maybe we'll have another round of questions. I have one thing I hope we can spend a little time on, but why don't we take some more from the floor? Your name is?
Sarah Bernard. Thanks very much. Very interesting. I wrote my PhD in economics on social entrepreneurship and the informal economy.
On what?
On social entrepreneurship and the informal
economy.
And I'm a student of Amartya Sen, and I'm really interested in this concept of what we're discussing. Institutional framework structures, of course, capabilities approach comes in here to understand a little bit how the choice issue and what we have at our availability in terms of enabling environments to make choices and all of those issues. But what I wanted to just build off of what you've already discussed, which is I'd like to get your impressions on what you think of what I spend a lot of time on, which is social enterprises as institutions, as structures, as organizational ways of organizing markets ethically, and then also if you had any just views on impact investing as one of these examples of maybe how we are embedding sort of collective ethos which doesn't throw self-interest away but looks at self-interest in other regarding.
What's impact investing?
Impact investing, the idea of taking traditional financial instruments and investing them into ideas, innovations, initiatives, companies that actually have social metrics for impact. So looking at basically making sure that the investments report back on how they're creating shared value or blended value in society. And if you thought of those ideas or vehicles as positive examples of where we're going.
We'll come back to the speakers, but in the meantime, yeah, in the back there.
I was just wondering if you see material inequality as something distinct from an ethical question, insofar as material inequality is mediated through society. It's always already ethical. So why have this distinction between a kind of neutral, non-ethical moment in capitalism versus then making the material inequality which arises simply a kind of procedural issue or a matter of practical concern. Insofar as material inequality is itself socially mediated, it's an ethical question.
Suresh in the back, I saw. Huh?
Okay, fine. it's shocking to me that very little of this conversation had anything to do with politics. The politics of the transition, the politics under capitalism, both inequality, political representation, and things like that. And John, I know you've worked on this, but I'd be curious to hear how this has sort of stayed on the plane of both the economy understood abstractly and then ethical evaluations of those understood abstractly with very little of sort of the actual tasks of political organizations
and
political
institutions.
Here?
What about the predatory nature of the political elites who take advantage of the system for their own enrichment?
Okay. One more, anybody? Yeah.
So what are some ways to cultivate that social ethos that you're talking about?
Okay. Maybe we'll go the other way this time.
Okay. Social entrepreneurship sounds fine to me. Most of the students I've met who talk about doing it simply want to find a way of assuaging their guilt and getting rich without being a greedy capitalist. I mean, from the students I've had. I teach a course on equality, and there are always a couple of students who are going to go into finance, and they find amazing ways of justifying going, you know, to work on Wall Street. I think they're just deluding themselves. So, I mean, I would much rather that a person who has some talent, you know, goes into science or art or something like that, than become and becoming a social entrepreneur. I don't believe many of those people are going to end up doing much other than enriching themselves. But I don't know the area, but that's my you know, based on my observation of Yale undergraduates, that's my feeling. I didn't understand the question on material inequality, so I'm skipping it. Suresh on mediation and so on. Suresh, politics. I'm interested in thinking about, as I said, the question of socialist design. The politics then is going to be very different from the politics now. As far as I'm concerned, the politics are simply playing out class struggle under capitalism. And I've written a lot about that. I think it's very interesting to understand how politics work as a way of studying class struggle, but I don't think there's a deep philosophical issue there. On the issue of political elites, predatory political elites, and so on, I think that's the same thing. That's part of the kind of industrial organization of class struggle. I mean, how political parties represent different classes imperfectly. They also have the selfish interests of politicians who have to act as class representatives in some sense, but also have their own interests and have to get elected. So all those things are, I think, very secondary issues and not so germane to the kind of discussion we're having here tonight. On how to cultivate the social ethos, my own view is that I think let's look at the Nordic countries, which I think have quite a socialist ethos. It's not universal, but it's quite a significant ethos. It's very different from the ethos in the United States. How was that achieved? I think it was achieved in large part as a consequence of having a welfare state. So in other words, but the welfare state was not initially motivated, in my view, by a concern for others. It was motivated as a self-interested system of insurance. Why did it succeed in getting implemented in these Northern European countries and Nordic countries, and much less so in the United States? It was also implemented in Great Britain and the rest of Europe to some extent. I think the traditional explanation of that has been that because these countries were homogeneous ethnically, religiously, and linguistically, they had a feeling of solidarity for each other, with each other, and hence were able to implement through a labor party this system of social insurance. But I think that's only part of the story. I think another very important part of the story, I think homogeneity was key, but I think that it was not necessarily key in running through the path of solidarity. I think the homogeneity also had the consequence that the population faced very similar risks. There was very little heterogeneity of risk. People had approximately the same educational levels. They faced approximately the same probabilities of unemployment, the same kinds of lifestyles because of this homogeneity, and faced the same kinds of probabilities of illness. And when you have a population that has very similar risks that it's facing, it's very easy to design social insurance, which everybody will agree to, from a totally self-interested point of view. So just to be more precise about it, suppose that we all face a probability of 10% of being unemployed. Then we will, as long as we're all risk-averse, we can be risk-averse and to very different degrees, but as long as we're all risk-averse, we will all prefer unanimously the following system. Tax us 10% of our income while we're working and pay us 90% of our income while we're unemployed. That will completely smooth our consumption so that we're always consuming 90% of our income, whether employed or not. That will be the universally preferred plan. But if one section of the population has a probability of 25% being unemployed, let's say blacks from the South, and another a probability of 5% being unemployed, there's no simple system that will not end up transferring money from one group to the other. No, in the sense of what's called fair insurance, actuarially fair insurance. So I think it was the homogeneity of these Northern European countries which made it easy for simple social insurance schemes to be implemented with universal approval, even if people were simply looking at the insurance from a totally self-interested viewpoint. Now, a second major part of that story was the Second World War, which did what? It destroyed wealth in Europe. Not in the United States, the war wasn't fought here, but it destroyed wealth. It homogenized wealth across the populations, and it created, I think, a unity of the middle class, the former middle class, and the working class for social insurance. It homogenized their risks. So I think it was the wiping out of wealth in Europe, plus the homogeneity of those populations, which, after the war, made social insurance politically a very easy thing to implement. Neither that homogeneity nor the wiping out of wealth happened in the United States. So this is a slightly pessimistic history, in the sense that is the only way to, and then I think the second part of the story, once you have those social insurance schemes, if they're really effective, as they are, were in the Nordic countries, I think people learn to have solidarity with, they learn to care about other people. They like a society in which there's no poverty. They like a society in which people aren't dying on the streets, you know, from lack of health insurance. And so if you look at the Olympic pageant from London last summer, you know, they glorified the National Health Service as one of their crowning achievements. It was an example of a health insurance scheme that may have been implemented purely for self-interested insurance reasons, but now people are genuinely proud of it. Proud, why? Because they like the society that it created. So they learned, I think their values changed as a consequence of having that insurance. So I think that's going to be the path to a socialist ethos. It's going to be through further episodes of successful cooperation. Now, nasty question is, how are we going to get that in the United States? Do we have to have another world war or a major financial crisis? I don't know.
Prabhat, can you tell us how we can destroy enough wealth in the United States?
No, you know, in 1931, Keynes wrote a famous article called Economic Fables for Our Grandchildren, in which he actually had said that the economic problem as we know it would disappear because of the fact that, you know, compound rate of growth, and as a result, you can imagine, over a number of years, there would be so much for everybody to have that the economic problem as we know it would disappear. But that was written in 1931, what, 82 years ago, and we still have enormous economic deprivation. And I believe that is because of the economic system which we are in. I mean, I think Keynes's article was brilliant, but I've never seen anything more wrong, despite being brilliant, than our economic fables for our grandchildren. Now, you know, I don't, by the way, agree with John that, you know, in India and China, poverty is disappearing. On the contrary, I really think there are very serious issues of poverty in India. In fact, if anything, it's even possible to argue that in the recent period of high growth, there has been an accentuation of poverty. And I don't believe that in China, poverty has disappeared. I mean, I think, on the contrary, there's substantial deprivation in terms of nutritional norms and so on in the Chinese population. So the point is, again, the kind of social system in which very high rates of growth take place not necessarily is one which actually manages that rate of growth to benefit the entire population. So the compound rates of growth formula that Keynes had worked out is something which really doesn't work. Which is why I believe that, you know, I mean, in fact, I agree with John about socialist ethos, but I think the socialist ethos would come through struggle. Firstly, I believe the socialist ethos is necessarily universalist, so that, you know, it's not something which is, let's say, I mean, a small community developing a socialist ethos in an incestuous manner is not, to my mind, socialist ethos. In other words, socialist ethos must necessarily reach out to humanity as a whole. It must be necessarily universal. And that, I'm not sure, can be developed through simply people becoming better off. I think that is something which necessarily comes through struggles and through common struggles. I mean, even when you are not struggling, but I'm struggling, I look to you for support. And I think that is a reaching out. So I think, you know, that is a very old-fashioned idea, which is basically what Marx said, that the genesis of socialism lies in the fact of struggle by the working class within capitalism. And I think the genesis of socialism in the future, at least certainly in countries like mine in the third world, would lie in the struggle of workers and peasants for a better society, because they are being deprived at this moment. Not because they are becoming better off, but because they are being deprived. That's the way I see it.
I remember the two other examples I have of cooperation in the last couple hundred years, which I think are important to give. First is urbanization. I mean, in the last 150 years, we've passed in many, many countries from being societies which were 80% rural to societies which are 80% urbanized or more. And cities are a fantastic example of cooperation. I mean, millions of people living cheek by jowl and not killing each other. Secondly, related to not killing each other, is the very sharp decline in violence over the last 10,000 years of human existence. I mean, this is discussed in a book recently by Steven Pinker called The Better Angels of Our Nature, in which he has massive evidence of the decline in violence. Even in the 20th century, with its two world wars, a smaller fraction of the global population was killed in violent manner or died in violent ways than was true in hunter-gatherer societies. Typically, 25% of men in hunter-gatherer societies died through war and intertribal war. And in the 20th century, something like 1%, maybe less than 1% of people died in violent ways. So these are big cooperative accomplishments. And I think, basically, they've been achieved through overcoming the material deprivation. I mean, urbanization was possible because it became possible through technological progress to produce all the food that people needed with a very small percentage of the population. And I think the decline in violence through wars has been happened mainly due to overcoming material deprivation.
I think we're probably reaching a point where we may want to move on. You have a thing you want to bring up? I was going to bring up one thing, so why don't you bring up yours, and then I'll throw out mine.
Well, on John's example on Scandinavia, like what came to my mind, and my general problem is also that I think that workers in the world rationally pursue their national interests rather than their economic interests. This is the biggest problem that reaches that no way of overcoming. And the situation that you described for the post-World War II Scandinavia, it's a very similar situation as it was for Maoist China. And I'm trying to understand why the Maoist China, the impoverished people were very close to each other with very little means, there was no elite anymore. Why this didn't evolve the way we would wish a socialist society evolves, like, but why it turned just the opposite direction.
Well, I think I'd like to invite a sort of last contribution on both speakers' parts. The thing that I would like to put on the table, given the unusual nature of this evening, is a little bit more about Marxism and where Marxism is going. One of the things that I find is that I find myself much happier listening to a discussion of this kind, even if I don't agree with everything that's said. Compared to most of what I hear, at least people are talking about things that I can recognize and that I think are real and are, you know, relevant to what's going on. And a lot of the discussion of economics and other social science tends to drift off into things that I don't recognize as being about anything real or whatever it might be. And I think I tend to associate that realism or the willingness to call a spade or to try to be realistic about the actual history and relations of our society as something that is connected to the Marxist tradition in a broad sense. Prabhat and John are in certain ways representatives of very different analytical tendencies in Marxist tradition. I was going to suggest that as part of a winding up presentation, I'd like to hear a little bit more about where each of you think the Marxist tradition is going at this point. And in particular, what do you think you learned from each other? Or what do you think your side of the Marxist tradition has to learn from the other ones? Doesn't have to be any particular one, but from other points of view that are in that broad connection. And since it's 8 o'clock, I think maybe we'll do that. I'm going to go now this way.
You made me start. So
okay, now it's perfect. Okay.
No, I mean, I just want to make 2 points. And firstly, I think John talked about scarcity, and many of us have talked about material deprivation. I mean, I think the question is scarcity relative to what? What is the norm? Relative to which we are really talking about scarcity? There is a tendency in Marxism to think in terms of the development of the productive forces, which is unbounded. You know, I mean, we go on developing productive forces. I think that is the version of Marxism which I don't accept. I call it productionism, because I think overcoming of scarcity is not just through increasing production, but also through, in a sense, limiting your wants. I mean, you know, in other words, when Marx was very young, he had written a letter to his father in which the following sentence occurs: "The more you have, the less you are." I mean, you know, in other words, put it this way: I mean, I'm not kind of celebrating asceticism. But on the other hand, I do think that this is an issue that Marxism must face up to. I mean, in other words, the distinction between productionism as a means to freedom and, in fact, as it were, controlling your destiny as a means to freedom. And controlling your destiny doesn't just mean having a high GDP growth rate. Okay. The second issue, which, you know, I mean, you're saying, I believe that at this moment, certainly I'm speaking from the Indian experience, that, you know, that there is a deep division within the Marxists between the degree to which you applaud productionism and the degree to which you actually take up struggles. And, you know, this is obvious. A whole bunch of peasants have to be removed for a development project. Does a Marxist party or a Marxist group support the peasants, or does it support the development project? Modernity, in quotes, productionism would make you support the development project. But on the other hand, many would support the peasants. I think that is a division which we have not been able to overcome.
John, you get the last word.
Well, okay, so I agree with Prabhat about limiting our wants, but I believe that human needs are biologically determined, largely, and that eventually there's going to be people are going to gravitate to understanding that there's the difference between needs and conspicuous consumption. So I think that we're now the best example I have that we're, I mean, I think the simplest statistic I can give for summarizing my claim, or for backing my claim that we're reaching the period of the of escaping material deprivation is the increase in life expectancy in the last 100 years. In 1900, global average life expectancy was 31 years, and now global life expectancy is 67. Maybe it's a little less than that, but it's in the 60s. In the United States, it was 47 in 1900, and it's now around 78. And my view is that's not going to keep increasing forever. It's going to taper off. We're going to reach a point where we have reached essentially biological limitations on increasing life. So I think but that's a real measure, I think, of the overcoming material deprivation, which was due not only to better nutrition and so on, but to education of women and to the development of antibiotics and so on. I think the conspicuous consumption that we have now, and that of course is nurtured by capitalism as an through advertising and through development of associating status with material consumption, I think that's going to pass as we overcome this period of relative deprivation. I really think it will. So I have a somewhat longer view, I think, than Prabhat. I mean, I think I'm thinking in terms of the next 500 years, which is, of course, a very small period with respect to the length of existence of the human species, which is now taken to be around 200,000 years. I think Keynes, in his essay, Prospects for Our Grandchildren, he said the big problem is going to be what we do with our leisure time, because we're overcoming the period of material deprivation. We are, for the first time in the history of mankind, escaping the period where we had to struggle for existence. And he predicted the length of the work week was going to fall. Well, he actually wasn't very far off. I mean, if you look at Germany, if you take the they work a 35-hour work week or whatever when they're working, but if you take the number of hours in the work year in Germany now and you amortize it over a 50-week year, which is what people were working in 1931, it's 28 hours a week. So the work year is definitely falling, and the work life in advanced countries is falling much faster than that, because much longer periods of retirement now exist. People still retire around the age of 65 or 62, but they live until they're 80. They don't die when they're 67, which used to be the case. So the fraction of adult life which is spent in labor has fallen drastically in the advanced countries. Keynes was right about that. What he didn't foresee, perhaps, is that it would take longer than 100 years for people to overcome the addiction to material consumption, to high conspicuous consumption. I think maybe the global warming problem that we're facing is going to help us learn to consume less and take more of our real wealth in the form of education and leisure activities of various kinds. So I'm much more optimistic than Prabhat, I think. I do think we're on the cusp of living in a very new period where our intuitions about the working class as being the primary movers of social change, which was true in a period of extreme scarcity and early capitalism, is no longer going to hold. Let me again end with another quote from G.A. Cohen, who has been my major teacher in terms of Marxism. So he said, the 19th century was a period in which the working class, there were three characterizations of the working class which all coincided. They were the people who had the power to bring down capitalism, they were the poor, and they were the exploited. But that's no longer true in 20th century capitalism. Workers, industrial workers, certainly aren't necessarily the people who have the power to bring down capitalism. They're not the poorest. The poorest are the unemployed and the people who live, on the fringes of the capitalist system. They're not the essence of what makes capitalism work. And they're not necessarily exploited. I mean, or at least not in the sense of being unfairly treated. And well, I think they are exploited, but the workers are exploited in the Marxian sense of the labor accounts. But that's not necessarily something that is unjust or egregious. So the people who are most suffering from injustice under the capitalist system are not the employed working class. I think we have to be more plastic in our interpretation of what's going to cause social change.
Okay, well, I will thank our speakers.